Hey guys, it's still the 7th. It's a beautiful evening. We're kind of clouded over. We had a little bit of rain here. But I wanted to tell you about our Tagai Tai run with the furniture. What happened was we drove around and we found the people we talked to before. And I had told her what size, but we didn't have the money then to order anything. So we went back today to the same lady. And we get in there to talk to her. And all of a sudden, the custom stuff, she doesn't really want to do it. She's hemming and hawing that it's going to be this, that, and the other. Then she gives us this ridiculous price. And also, it wasn't going to be the same wood. It was going to be a different kind of wood. And I think they just made a deal on a different kind of wood. Hi, Bob. It was, I think they said cashew wood or something. It was like an orangey-looking wood. Didn't seem as heavy. And all of a sudden, no, we can't get that. We can't get the other wood. So I was like, okay. So, you know what? I told him, let's just get out of here. There's 100 furniture places over here. Well, what happened was when we seen some more furniture places, I pulled over and my wife got out and just sort of, she ran across the street. And then she went to a couple of them, and I don't want to be seen. You know, when we first start to make a deal, I don't want to be seen, because then of course the price goes up. So finally I see her, I get out of the car after about 15, 20 minutes, and I start walking down and I see her at the place. She had my notebook with the sizes I need. She worked everything out with the lady. The lady gave us a price. It's the nice wood. So we got the table and the chairs, and then we're going to have them make a, instead of a coffee table, it's going to be a coffee box, okay? And that way there are going to be hinges on it so we can lift the lid up and we can put the games in it, stuff like we're going to use in the, when we're watching the TV. And then also we got them to make us a thing for our bed, to raise our bed up off the floor, because for me in the mornings, it's really hard for me to get up off the floor. I need to throw my feet over the side and sit there for a minute sometimes. So that's why I didn't get any pictures, because I didn't want to be trucking down the lane with the camera and not even finding her. And then when I went in there, she had already cut the deal with the lady. Got everything we needed. They said they're going to make the stuff in 3 to 4 weeks, so we gave them half the money. And it was right around $1,000 for everything. And my wife was saying, well, that's so expensive. Well, you know something? It's what it costs, is what I say. This stuff is heavy-duty furniture. We got the bench in the back we wanted. We got the table. We got the 4 chairs that'll go under the table when we're not using them. You know, so it's what it costs. You know, I'm not sweating it. And then the box, they're custom making us this box. It's going to be 16 by 32, 20 inches high. There's going to be a little, you know, I had them put a couple of blocks on the bottom, you know, to raise it up off the ground so we can clean underneath there and all that stuff. And, you know, that's going to be very nice. And it's just going to be super. And it's done. We're done with it. And that furniture is some heavy-duty stuff, and it'll be around long after we're gone. So I don't think that's too much money. Whenever you're buying, you know, durable goods like that, that's just how it goes. I remember when I was a young kid, my mother got a table. And it was this beautiful hand-carved table and thing. It was handed down to her, and then she had it. Well, it didn't go in our upstairs. She was using it as a closed table in the basement, and it wound up going to one of my sisters. You know, this stuff just keeps getting handed down. You know, you take care of furniture, it lasts a long time. Now we got the kids. Yeah, they mess up stuff. That's why I got the dark-colored couch. And now we got this. We picked this up the other day. And when we got messy foods, we come out here and eat breakfast. We're going to have an awning. I bought this really cool awning yesterday. My wife and I picked it out. It's a retractable job, but we're going to hang that up there. This we want to cover over with an awning. And yeah, sometimes we're going to eat out here. We don't have to always eat in the house. But this is just how we're going to do it. But that's why I didn't get any picture stuff of the wood shops. It would have been nice to see the wood shops and stuff, But they'll be bringing it here. They're going to bring it here, deliver it, and set it up. My wife, she haggled with them, got free shipping. And she gave them the address and a phone number. 3 to 4 weeks, and they're going to give us a call the day before so we can be ready for them. Before that, the couch will be here. So we got lots of stuff to do yet. We got to get a cabinet for over in here yet so I can get all this stuff put away. And then our boxes that are in the dining room, they'll go up in the hallway for now until we get the bed up on its stilts. And then we'll start putting stuff underneath there. That'll be kind of like a storage area for us. And then I want to get a real nice one of them flat out wet mops so we can get in there and keep the dust bunnies down and all that. So far, this house is just not dusty. But we'll see how that goes once they start building new houses around. They're building one over here. They started with the footers. They got the uprights for the concrete stuff in. The fellows that are working on it are real nice guys. My wife gets some hot water and gets them some coffee in the morning. You know, and they're... You know, I said this before to my wife. When these construction guys are here... Give them coffee in the morning. Give them something to eat. I got a soft spot for these guys. I really do. I have a soft spot for construction workers here in the Philippines because I was a construction worker and I was paid very well for what I did. And all of us guys that built things were paid very well. The trades is very good paying. I can't understand these dummies going into liptard schools and getting a... psyche and blah 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 whatever degree they're going to get, and then they can never find a job. You know, whereas you go into the trades, you get paid for your training because you're working while you're training, and boom, then when you're done, you can make $100,000 a year. You know, and if you want to work overtime, you can make $150,000 easy. I did it. I paid taxes on $150,000 many a year. You know, so. That's just how it goes. So I have a soft spot for these guys. My wife was talking to them. They get $450 a day here. And they start when the sun goes up, and you see these guys working real late. They just finished up a little bit ago. And it's late. What time is it now? It's 6:30 now. So, you know, they work long hours, and it's not an easy job for these guys for $450. So we're talking, you know, think about that for a minute. $450, that's... Nine bucks a day is what they get. That's rough. You know, that's really rough. So I do have a soft spot for them. And as long as these guys are working anywhere around here, any of these construction workers, we're going to go ahead and we're going to do whatever we can for them, whatever they want. I don't care. And then we got Mama went back home. And Faye was talking to these guys over here. They need somebody. Her brother, who's out of work right now, he's a construction dude. He's been working construction for years and years, all aspects of it. So they want to take a look at him. So when Mama comes back, she's going to bring the brother. And then he might get a job here. And he'll take that because he'll live on site here with these guys. And I told him, you know, we help him out, you know, like in the mornings with hot water and, you know, whatever the guys need. I seen the one guy, the one guy was holding the hose over top of the other guy. Well, you know, he soaped up, he washed his whole body, and then the other guy's holding the hose right out in the open is how they have to take their shower and bath. So, you know, we're going to do stuff for them. We're going to give them on and give them stuff to eat and stuff like that just because they it's rough for these guys. And, if you know, that's just something that, you know, we're doing great. You know, we're doing great. I'm going to be down again on the money because I forgot about the car insurance this month. But next month, we're going to be good. We pretty much got all the stuff. Tomorrow I got to do my big food shopping, and then when I get home, I got to start getting stuff hung. My sweetie's going to help me hang the TV. We're going to hang the one upstairs. I got to get the sound bar in. We just got a boatload of stuff to do. What's up, dude?
From my robot, right?
Yeah, that's from your robot. That's my little buddy. Well, I'm going to let you go. I don't want to make this one too long, but you know, we had a pretty successful day. We got our banking done. I had to get that. we have to deposit it. They don't let you just pay the car insurance. You have to put it in your car insurance account at their bank. So you got to go. You have to go, not to the insurance place. You have to go to their bank, give them the account number, deposit the money, then you get a receipt for it. And the stupid thing was, the lady that had been texting me said, as soon as you get the receipt, send us proof that you paid it. And I'm like, it's your account. It just seemed really stupid to me that I'm depositing money in their account. They should be able to see that, but I have to send the receipt to her. I guess that's so she can find it. You know, in this country, one hand doesn't know what the other hand's doing. It's just really crazy what goes on here. The other thing, too, and I just want to tell you this, guys. When we were driving, I think they passed a law here in the Philippines this morning that said if you're a tricycle driver on the highway, you're supposed to only go 20 kilometers per hour, and you're not allowed to get out of the way. You have to stay up in the fast lane. I think that just happened. I couldn't believe all the tricycles that were just holding up traffic like crazy, and they would not pull over. There's a right lane. They could pull over the right lane. They won't. They won't do it. And I was just shaking my head. It was just, you know, my wife, when she starts, she's going to start driving here pretty soon. The next thing I said after the bike, we got to get her a buggy, and then we're going to send her to the A1 driving school because I don't want to train her. I tried to train her before, and it's just pulling my hair out of my head. You know, I've trained other people how to drive, my kids and all kinds of stuff. Never had a problem, but she goes and gets it in first gear and starts it rolling. And then once she goes to second, she lets it stop before, and then puts it in second, tries to burn the clutch. So she's going to go to an A1, let her run those cars. And she has to learn stick shift. She has to, because that's mostly what we got. You know, so she's going to have to learn that. And we're going to get her something. If I can find her an automatic, we're thinking of one of those Suzuki vans, if we can find her an automatic. But after that, she's going to find out how stressful the driving is here. You know, something about that, when you drive here, you just have to be as inconsiderate as they are. That's the only way you're going to get anywhere here. Don't let anyone... Hi, baby. Don't let anyone... No, not yet. But don't let anyone in. Don't cut anybody any slack. You have to be the one in the front. If somebody gets in front of you and noses in and smash your car, it's your fault, because whoever's in the front is the one who wins the court case. So don't let anyone get in front of you. You have to drive cutthroat, just like these guys. You know, I've said this before. When I lived in the States and here, the nicest people you'll ever meet are Filipinos. And I've been in Europe. I was in England. I was in India. I was in China. And I drove in a couple of those places. I didn't drive in China, though. But I was in a car in them. But you want to see an instant a-hole? Put a Filipino behind the wheel, guys. That's all you got to do. They just, it's cutthroat here. But that's how they drive. It's neither good nor bad. You just have to, know it. You have to know it when you come here. Put away all this stuff about being a nice guy and being letting people in. Because if you let one person in, 50 of them are going to come filtering in, and your whole lane's going to be blocked forever. You know, and then when you finally get ready to go, 20 motorcycles are going to cut in front of you. So you can't do that. You have to put that out of your mind. You don't have to be mad at everybody. Do just like the Filipinos look. When you cut somebody off, just don't look at them. That's what they do. Or tint your windows out so black that they can't see you. Now, I understand the tinting laws in the States, and I like them. Here in this country, that third brake light is absolutely worthless because you can't see. You can't see the car in front of you. Hello, Bob. Hello. You can't see anything in front of you because the windows are so blacked out. And then at nighttime, they're all running their high beams, and they're blinding the crap out of you because they're all blacked out. So I do understand now in the States why they have the tint laws, and I don't think it's a bad thing. Now, I'm not one going to say they need to abolish that here, and this is none of my damn business, but I'm just going to tell you, you have to have the following distance, and you're going to find out when you drive here, when you try to have the following distance, because you can't see the guy in front of the guy in front of you, you can't see his brake lights. So you got, and you're never going to have a, if you leave one half of a car length in between you and the car in front of you, six guys are going to cut in front of you guys. It's what's going to happen. It's going to happen to you. You're going to see. When you get here and you start driving, you're just going to shake your head. And if you can't take anything like that, make sure you're way the hell out in the country. Or just pay a driver anytime you want to go anywhere. Personally, myself, if I'd known what I've known now, I would not have bought that car right there. I wouldn't have bought it. I'd have just paid for drivers all the time. It would have cost me about the same, you know, because that car was $749,000 is what that thing cost. And then I got insurance a year, $18,000 a year for insurance on it. And then, of course, I got maintenance. You know, I do the maintenance. That's always, you know, $4,000 or $5,000 for the maintenance every 6 months. And then I'm going to be needing tires soon. So I could have got a van. I could have rented a van. You know, we went to Manila one time and we rented a van. The guy only wanted like 500 pesos. And then we had to give him a little gas. When we had the dude come with the big truck, he came with a big truck with all of our stuff in it to move into this house. 60, his total trip from when he left was 67 kilometers one way, and he paid all the tolls and everything, and it only cost me $3,500. And they moved us. He had guys with him that carried all the stuff in. I didn't even have to carry any heavy stuff. So, you know, don't drive. If you're going to be frustrated easy, don't drive. But if you can come here and you can get behind the wheel and turn into the rottenest prick, you'll do well here, because it's every man for himself here. And that's the whole thing in the entirety of the Philippines. It's what I see. It's everybody for themselves, the way they run their systems here, you know. And also, if you don't know somebody, you know, you're not going to get anywhere. You know, people who know somebody, they'll get right in the front of the line. All kinds of stuff like that. So you expats that are planning on coming here, and it looks like they're going to open it up before too long.
They have peanuts.
Okay, you want to get ready to say the magic stuff?
Rickshaw out.
And don't forget to pray for each other. Rickshaw out.